ourselves. So in other words, in a nutshell, what I'm trying to say is men are not animals. And if you've been a man long enough, at some point or another, somebody probably calls you a dog. Maybe I'm the only one, but you know, you make a woman mad enough, he dogged me out. He ain't nothing but a dog. And that mentality begins to set in men's mind. So much so we begin to carry ourselves as such. But men are not dogs, we're better than them. And we shouldn't carry ourselves like dogs. That mentality became so great that somebody made a song, The Atomic Dog. Then he says, why must I be like that? And you know the rest. He says, nothing but the dog in me. Then he had the nerve to say, wow, 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 yippee-yo, yippee-yo. He said these things because something triggered in him to make himself, put himself on the same playing field as a dog. And we see it in the streets that our young brothers carry themselves like animals. No value for human life. Because they don't view humans as being made in the image of God. Don't value each other's life. Don't value each other's property. Men are not animals. But we're made in the image of God. We are the reflection of God himself in the earth. God needed this to be so. He wanted this to be so. He wanted to have representatives of himself in the earth. And he chose mankind. He chose you, he chose me to be representatives. There are three characteristics that men possess to confirm that we are made in the image of God. There are three characteristics that we possess that confirm that we're not like animals, that we're actually made in the image of God. The first one being personality. And personality is basically knowledge, feelings, and free will. We have a personality. All of us in here, we have a different IQ, different intellect. You see people, they have different goals, different values, different ways they do things. We have different personalities. But I don't care if you get a poodle or a Rottweiler or a pit bull, they're all dogs. They all have the same mentality. They all have the same way of being. They are all animals. But God gave us a personality. Knowledge, we can learn. If you don't know something, if you keep trying, you can learn. And then not only can we learn, but we can teach others. See, you can teach a dog a trick, but that dog can't teach that trick to other dogs. You can teach a dog tricks, but that dog can teach that same trick to other dogs. Yes, sir.
I'm talking about my neighbor. He had a dog, and he was getting in the trash can. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking about the mic. I said, Coco, I did my trash can. He said, I said, here's another dog. He said another dog had his dog standing up his trash. I said, okay.
He blamed on the other dog instead of just saying it was Coco.
No, it wasn't Coco.
So that's what separates us from humans, that we all have unique personality. We have the ability and the capacity to learn. We can gain knowledge and we can teach knowledge. And we have feelings. We have feelings. We can feel love and compassion, sorrow, pain. We have feelings. We have emotions and free will. We have free will to, we know right from wrong. for life. It was put in us when God created us after his image and his likeness. Secondly, we have, not only do we have a personality, but we have morality. We are able to make moral judgments, and we have a conscience, meaning we know right from wrong, and if we choose to do wrong instead of right, it bothers us.
Yes.
It bothers when you do something wrong, it'll bother you. Animals are not like that. If a child falls in the pit of a lion at the zoo, the lion will devour the child and won't think nothing about it. He will not lay around depressed. He will not stop eating. He will do it over and over and over again because he is an animal. And he is created to devour. But if we do something we know is wrong, we may do it anyway, and we know that it's wrong, it will bother you. See, I used to be somewhat of a street cat type of guy that would do what I had to do to get money. But I was raised right. I didn't have to do what I did, but I done it because I was good at it. I had a good education, had good parents, had good upbringing, raised in the church, but at some point I chose to do wrong. But my conscience would whoop me. Over and over and over again, I would always hear what my mama say, evil communication corrupts good manners. It seems like she had that pin in my heart. If I misused or mistreated a lady, although I was trying to be hard in front of my friends, I would go home and say, what would my grandmother think? What would my mother think? It bothered me. Because there was a moral compass on the inside of me. I couldn't see it, but it was there. Yeah. And every single one of us have it. You don't believe me? You go to prison, you get locked up. I've been locked up, I know. You got people that they will sit there and they will cry at night. Because something on the inside of them knows that they messed up. They have a conscience. We all have one. Some of us better at ignoring it than others. But it still don't change the fact that we are moral creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And God created us to be that way. Because it's a direct reflection of who he is. Mm-hmm. So not only do we have personality, morality, but we have spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
You remember when Jesus told the woman in John chapter 4, he says, God is a spirit, and they that worship me must worship me in spirit and that in truth. He says, he seeketh such to worship. God made us spiritual. We are spiritual beings. That's why you have young brothers, they're always seeking for spirituality, always seeking newfound faiths and religions. It's because there's a void in us that we can't explain what it is. It's the Spirit of God. We need him. We need contact with him. We need fellowship with him. We need communion with him. Spirituality, that means that we were made for communion with God. God made us to commune with him, to have a relationship, a fellowship. But now we see, especially in African American culture, we've gotten away from that. We have a generational gap in the church now. There's a fall off in the church.
Yes,
it is. Used to everybody went to church on Sunday.
Yes.
Now he can ride by his more folks at the car wash than in his church. It may not be like that in Bastrop. There's more people barbecuing and kicking it, playing dominoes and busting some spades on Sunday than it is in church. And we wonder why our younger generation are longing and they're empty on the inside. Because they're missing something that they was created to have. Yes. Communion with God.
Yes.
Spirituality, a connection, a divine connection.
Yes.
That can give us the only thing that's going to really satisfy us.
Mm-hmm.
See, we'll never be satisfied outside of fellowship with God. I don't care what you do.
Mm-hmm.
You can have money, I've had it.
Oh. Yes.
It won't satisfy you. You can have women, I've had them. They won't satisfy you. We longing for that connection. We longing for something. As men, we longing for something. We may have a good personality. We may be pretty moral. But if spirituality is cut off, something is missing in a man's life.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Then because it's missing, he don't know what's going on. He takes it out on everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Wife can't do nothing right. You keep quitting jobs. Mm-hmm. You get mad at everybody.
Yeah.
Because we're missing something. The only thing that can give us fulfillment is communion, fellowship, or relationship with God.
Amen.
But the problem is a lot of times we feel like we've done too much. God don't want to talk to me. You know, Adam done it. The moment Adam messed up, he put a barrier between him and God. He took fig leaves, put them on, he created a barrier, and then he fled. He didn't want to commune with God like he used to the point to where God said, Adam, where are you? God wasn't asking Adam his geographical location. God knows everything. God wanted Adam to admit where he was spiritually.
Yes.
So my question is, where are you, men? Where are you spiritually? And you know when you're on your Google Maps and you're trying to get somewhere, you got to admit where you are before you can get where you're going. Because
right.
It says, is it okay for me to use your current location?
Amen.
So you can't even get where you're going until you first admit where you're at. So we have to go back to the basics to admit how far we've fallen. How far have we fallen as men? Who are we in the community? Are we spiritual enough? Do our children see us praying? Do our grandchildren see us praying? Do they see us in church on Sunday lifting up, holding hands, or do we think that's just for women? When David, who was the king and more powerful than any one of us, danced out of his clothes.
He sure did.
When Solomon, who went from one end of the earth to the other seeking out the pleasure, he came to the realization that it's all vanity. He says, nothing pleased me more than obeying God. He understood the importance of spirituality over materialism. Stuff, women, pride, ego. I know I've had it. I understand it. I mean, I know how easy it is. And still got a lot of it. And damn pride. To where you know you need to cry, but I don't want to cry. We all have it. And it's got its place. There's times we have to be strong. But we can't sacrifice fellowship with God for our pride and our ego. So those are the three characteristics men possess to affirm that we are made in the image of God: personality, morality, and spirituality. Amen?
Amen.
Are there any comments? Anybody got any comments? Anything you want to say? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Hello, everybody. My name is Daryl. I just wanted to reiterate on the three different personalities that you said about
yes,
the man. Man is also a threefold
yes,
individual. And you have the spirit,
mm-hmm.
you have the body, and then he has the soul.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we are wrestling, the war has been waged in our mind. And we are wrestling against the sinful nature.
Mm-hmm.
He also has three natures in him. He has the human nature, he was born with the sinful nature,
mm-hmm.
and then there's the divine nature. And the sinful nature and the divine nature is tugging war against the human nature.
Yes, sir.
And we're right in the middle.
Yes, sir.
And then you can tell which one is dominating you by how you live your life.
Yes, sir.
Who are you? You are subject to. Who's your father?
Yes, sir.
That's why it's good to have a personal relationship with your Heavenly Father, because you may have to pray for someone, and your prayers will have to be able to reach heaven.
Yes, sir.
You call on your knees, talk about our Father,
coming before, trying to intercede for someone, might have broke their leg or something. And he looked at our father, what you been? I ain't heard from you in 6 months. But now you looking for me to do something for you. But the point I'm getting at is that these three natures, well, you have brought out a good point about the emotions and the morality and things like that. It's that Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Notice how that number three is governing our lives. You know, I'll finish later on and get somebody else down to say something. But I just want to bring that to your attention.
Yes, sir. Thank you. That's wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you, brother. Anybody else before I move on? So we got to realize that it was God's plan to make man in his image and likeness so that they would be a reflection of him in the earth. And then we know that man failed at this, so God had to send his son Jesus, is what the brother was talking about. God had to send his son Jesus to fulfill what the first man failed at. God said, I need reflection, I need representation on earth. First man failed, he sends his second Adam, which is Jesus. And Colossians 1 and 15 makes that plain. I think it's a perfect scripture for the point. And according to the New Living Translation, it says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. See that word there? Image. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. Now here is Jesus who comes just so God can have a reflection here on earth. To the point where Jesus said, you've seen me, you've seen the Father. God wanted this. He wanted to be able to relate to his people. And don't get it, we don't want to get it twisted. To see, well, we want to say that God has, he has hands, he has eyes, and we want to get so caught up in this physical. But God made us the way that he made us so we can relate to him. He says his ears are not too hidden where he can't hear us. His arms are not too short where he can't reach down and grab us. His eyes are in every place. God speaks. He spoke, let there be light, and light was. So we have all these attributes in the natural body to help us understand God better.
Amen.
And Jesus came and operated in this physical world simply so we can understand God better. And also so we can't ever say that God hadn't been tempted or went through some of the same stuff we're going through. He did it to relate to us. Not only did God make man a reflection, but he gave man dominion. You see it there in the text. He says, let us make man, verse 26, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion. Let them have dominion. Before God even created man, he decreed that he would have dominion. So what is this dominion? It's the ability to affect your environment. It's the ability to affect your environment. We got dominion. We got dominion over the animals. We got dominion over the things of the sea. We got dominion over the trees. And where I'm from, I see a misappropriation of dominion. God gave us this power. God gave us this authority. God gave us the ability to affect our environment. And it's somewhat a sin for us to mishandle this dominion.
Yeah.
You see all these mills that's up all over the earth, paper mills, all these different types. Of course, they employ a lot of people, but if you're like me, And you ride around and you see where you've lived for 30 years or 40 years, and you see the environment and how there's no trees as far as you can see. Is God pleased with the way we've impacted our environment? Pollution, global warming, and all these different types of things. Is God pleased with it? Gentlemen who go out and slay animals in droves just to make trophies out of it. Is God pleased with it? It goes back to that male pride. It goes back to the ego. It goes back to us desiring more and giving less. God gave us dominion, the ability to affect our environment, good or bad. So whatever's going on in Bastrop, whatever's going on in Monticello, we have the power to impact our environment. Resources. God gave us dominion. If we have children, God gave us authority over those children. All the people that run up and down the road and doing whatever it is they're doing, they're somebody's child. At some point, could it be, not in all cases, because we know some good parents' kids go astray, but could it be in some cases somebody slack in their authority and in their dominion? And it started with their communion with God.
That's right.
They gave a choice whether they're going to go to church or not.
You're absolutely right.
Yeah, see, I didn't have no choice. I didn't have a choice. She made me go. To the point to where I didn't even try to act like I didn't want to go because I knew it wasn't going to happen. And if we have to get back to those bases, God gave man dominion because we was created in his image, in his likeness. He didn't give dominion to no other created being but us. And that goes back to Psalms chapter 8, verses 4 and 5. Deacon Lee made reference of it earlier. It says, the psalmist says, what is man that you are mindful of him? So basically, some say, what is it about man that you're mindful of him? Why did you give man everything you gave him? When you created everything, why did you bless man so? You didn't do it for nothing else but man. Why? What is it about man that you're mindful of him? And the son of man that you visit him? When we sit, God visit us.
That's right.
So you can make it bad in hell. No, I'm down.
Yeah.
I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be with you always, even unto the end of time. And that's the type of God we serve.
That's right.
That he's there for us. He says, when you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor, you have made him have dominion over the works of your hands. God, you made this stuff, and then you gave it over to man. You took time out to fashion everything and make it to your liking, and then you turn around and give it to man. What is it about man that makes you so mindful of him? It's because we are his. We are in his image and his likeness. That's why our father can work so long and pay for a vehicle, and then when his son turns 16, he turns it over to him. What is it about that boy that makes you do this? Families that work forever take buy homes and then wills it to their children. Why? Because they're mine. They're made in my image and in my likeness. You see the similarities with my son. If my son walked through here now, you wouldn't have to ask him who his daddy is. He's mine. So whatever is mine is his. I'm mindful of him. Everything I do is for my legacy. I'm mindful of him.
Yeah.
I don't live for my first name. I live for my last name. I'm mindful of him.
Yeah.
He's always on my mind. They are always on my mind.
Yeah.
I must hand it over to them. Mm-hmm. They come from me. They in my image and in my likeness. Same is true with God. So if we begin to think like this, it may shape our actions. It'll shape our worship. It'll shape the way we treat one another. So when we feel like we don't have nothing, we can look around and say we have everything.
Amen.
Come on and give God glory. So he gave man dominion. The third principle I want to talk about is the fact that there's a difference between men and women. Help us, Lord. I might even drink a little water before I say that. There is a difference between men and women. So if we look at let's look at verse 27. Somebody, would you read that, please, verse 27? Genesis chapter 1, verse 27.
So God created man in his own image.
Mm-hmm.
In the image of God created him, male and female created him.
Hmm. So we see where God, this is once again an overview of what God is getting ready to do in chapter 2. And those of us who know our Bibles, we know how that went about it. We know how God went about making man and then fashioning woman from man. But here, this is an overview. This is an overview of God's plan. He reiterates this again to let us know how serious it is about us being made in his image and his likeness. But then we got to understand that Adam was not some man that God was going to create that struggled with identity. Meaning it wasn't, some people use this as an excuse to say Adam was a man with a woman living in him. You know how people make these little excuses now. No, God had every intention on making man and woman two different people. Adam was not struggling with identity. Because to say Adam struggled with identity, that would say that God didn't know what he was doing. Adam was not struggling with identity. And we need to teach this all over the world. Because I'm pretty sure that somebody who is in an identity crisis will take this and say that Adam had two people living in him. Like Bruce. God makes no mistakes. Amen? So we want to clear that up before we move forward. In our day, many say there is no real difference between men and women. You got people that will say there's really no difference between men and women. This makes sense. If we, it says, so God, differences between men and women are not accidents. Since he created them, the differences are good and meaningful. The differences to God are not accidents. He made them like that on purpose. In other words, men are not women and women are not men. I'm going to say that again. Men are not women. And women are not mean. One of the saddest signs of our culture. Ain't that good news? Could you imagine what they go through for 9 months?
My Lord.
Oh Lord. I've been in there. I wouldn't want to go. Says one of the saddest signs of our culture's depravity is the amount and the degree of gender confusion today. There's great gender confusion today. You turn on the television, you see it, and they've put it in us so much in the media to where they have desensitized us to it.
Uh-huh.
not as sensitive about it as we used to be. We don't really make a big deal about it as much anymore, because it's everywhere you turn. It's everywhere you look. You can't watch a good show now and they put it in there.
Yeah.
Subliminal messages to cause you to be okay with it. See, if you make men and women equal on that spectrum, you take men's responsibility from them. And some men don't mind it. But that's not the way God intended it.
That's right.
Help us, Lord. See, there are things that a man can do that no matter how hard a woman tries, she would never be able to do it. The same is also true about women. I don't care how a man dresses like a woman, walks like a woman,
yeah,
talks like a woman, or even has an operation to make himself look like a woman.
All right.
He will never be a woman. In God's eyes, he will always be a man. I don't care how he tries, and the responsibility that God intended for him to have from the beginning is still on his shoulder. He's trying to run from it. He's trying to escape it. But the responsibility, the truth of the matter, is that it's in black and white in this book, and it's true all the time. And he can't escape it. No matter how hard he tries. He will never be alone. Men and women are different for a reason.
Yeah.
And those differences were intended by God to fulfill his divine plan.
Yeah.
And his divine plan was for us to procreate.
Yeah.
Yeah. Adam and Steve can't make no baby. Eve and Yvette, they can't make no babies. So a big part of God's plan, not the only reason, but the big part of God's plan was procreation.
Yeah.
Multiplication.
Yeah.
For population.
Yeah.
And you need a man and a woman to do that. So there's a difference between men and women, and we need to get a strong grasp. Not a long time, I'm just going to do that. 15 minutes. Fourth point I want to make is God gave man a responsibility. So we get to the meat of that. God gave man a responsibility. We look at verse 28. It says, then God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it.
Mm-hmm.
Then he says it again, have dominion.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He gives God gives man responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what a lot of brothers trying to escape.
Yeah.
They trying to escape the responsibility of manhood.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When your wife is in labor and she has the baby in the living room, when the doctor says it's a boy, as soon as he can learn, we should be teaching him the responsibility that comes with being a man. Mm-hmm. I mean, as soon as he can understand that responsibility of being a man should be imparted in him. Even if he has a younger sister or older sister, you have to start teaching him how to treat women by treating the women that's around him every day the right way.
Yes.
You have to teach him how to manage his money. You have to teach him how not to walk around broke. You have to teach him how to rake leaves and pick up paper and do all these things before he does what he wants to do. Work now, play later. That has to be taught. Responsibility has to be taught. He has a portion of the house that's his own, his bedroom. He has to learn how to tend to it.
Amen.
He has to learn how to keep it clean.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
He has to learn these things early.
Yes.
Can't do it when he gets 16.
Uh-huh.
Too late.
Yeah.
gave us responsibility. He said, be fruitful, multiply. You see that? Be fruitful. We took that and ran with it. We took that and ran with it. See, God gave mankind a desire for sex. He gave me that desire. And we used it. We'll say, I'm a man. I just can't help it. I'm just a man. Say it all. I hear it all the time. I used to say it. What you expect from me? You don't know what it feels like to be a man. He gave us that desire for sex, which will make populating of the earth quick and light. God gave it to us so that we can populate the earth. Check this out. However, many thought that being fruitful and multiplying was God's only a main purpose for sex. But that isn't the case. The primary reason God created sex was to contribute to the bonding of a one-flesh relationship. God intended for us as men to have a life partner. I know we don't want to hear that, but it's the truth. The ideal way of doing things is to keep yourself until you get married, meet the woman that God wants you to be with, marry her, and multiply. That means you're not bringing any baggage in from the past relationships. You don't have anything to compare what you two do together with what else you've experienced. See, that breaks up a lot of relationships because you experimented. Then you say, oh, Lord, you be thinking to yourself. Y'all know what I mean. And it makes it hard on the marriage. Because we took the desire to have sex and to be fruitful to run out. We don't care nothing about the relationship. The one flesh bond, the union between man and woman. Oh, no, we don't really care about that. We just want to fulfill our lust and our desire. That's not what God intended. Just because you got the feeling and the urge, that don't mean he wants you to run out. Why? Because animals have sexual relations only for reproduction. And like I said, we are not animals. That's what animals do. A dog don't have to have no relationship with a female dog. She can run around the neighborhood and they just all stand in the line. Because it's a heat season and they just taking their turn. We men, right? We got to realize one of the greatest downfalls is our inability to keep ourselves. It gets us every time. Because the desire is greater than our willpower. It's greater than your willpower. Don't care who you are, I mean, sometimes it's just, you know, it just takes a toll on. We got to realize that God gives us everything that we need to change the life of God. Amen?
Amen.
So God gave us responsibility, and then he gave us a wife. Notice, before God gave man a wife, he gave him a job. Oh, Lord Jesus. Before God gave him a woman, he gave him a responsibility. He gave him a job. Don't take my word for it. Let's look at Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15.
You need to read it?
Yes, sir, you don't mind. Genesis 2, 15.
And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it.
He put him in the garden and said, now look here. You're going to dress this thing? You're going to keep it. This is your job. Before you got a woman, you need to learn how to work. That's one of the biggest problems that I see. I'm going to just read what I wrote down so I won't get in nobody's business. It says, men today tend to do things opposite of the plan of God. He wanted man to be the one to carry the bulk of the responsibility. Someone the woman can look to for support, guidance, leadership, and love. Today, in most cases, the roles have been reversed. The wife does most of the work and handles the majority of the responsibility. A wife should help meet the needs of the family and keep with the, and help with the responsibility, but no man should feel comfortable with her taking on his role as head of the house. No man should feel comfortable. I'm not saying that it's happening, but you shouldn't be content with it. You should always be progressing, trying to make yourself better and put yourself in a position for headship. No man should feel comfortable with his wife taking on his role as head of the house. He should strive to be who God called him to be.
Amen.
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 He should strive to be who God. He should strive to be who God called him to be. And the only way we can do that, my brothers and my sisters, is if we revisit the basics. Mm-hmm. Go back to the fundamentals, the foundation of what God created. I know it's hard. We live in times where it's hard to be human, let alone a man. And the pressures that we endure as men, sometimes our wives don't understand. Sometimes the community does not understand. The legislators don't understand what we go through at times. But I want to let you know that there's hope for us. Everything that we need is in the risen Savior.
Yes.
His name is Jesus.
Yes.
He's with us. He'll give us everything that we need.
Amen.
All we have to do is call on. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to read these verses and I'll take my seat. You look at Genesis, or somebody else if you will read Genesis chapter 2, verses 21 through 24. And this will conclude my lecture for this evening.
And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And so that's it.
So we ever had, thank you, brother.
Yes,
if we've ever had any, questions on how we should treat our wife, how we should treat a woman,
period.
Especially our wife, we should treat her like Adam did. He saw even God presented her to him. He was at lost words, all he could say, flesh of my flesh, bone of my bone.
Yeah.
Don't nobody want to hurt yourself.
No.
Don't nobody want to hurt yourself down to the bone.
No.
So we view it. We go back to the basics. We see her for who God created her to be as men. We can treat her with respect and dignity as God intended for us to. Amen?
Amen.
May God really bless you, brothers. I thank you for this opportunity.
Amen. Amen.
This time we're going to call on Scott to come and give us a humanity summation of our election.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I'm Minister Scott. For those of you who don't know, I'm here at Second Baptist quite often.
Amen.
Not as often as I'd like to be, but I get by here as much as my rigorous schedules would allow me to.
Yes, sir.
Would you all come with me and pray for me?
Yes.
The most gracious and honorable God and Father. Father, Lord, we come to you at this moment, Father, just to say thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
God, we thank you for this night. We thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for your many blessings, Father. Father God, we thank you for the angel of this house, Father, for allowing us to come together here tonight, Father. We thank you for the ones that put this program together, Father. We ask that you would bless this program, Father. We ask that there will be knowledge to come from this program, Father. That there will be wisdom to come from this program, God. To enable us to live better lives, God.
Yes, yes.
To enable us to be a better light to someone, God.
Yes, God.
God, we thank you for all that you have done and all that you're going to do, God.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To follow up with what Brother Daniels has displayed to us tonight, you all mind if I get a little comfortable? I had to endeavor a little deeper into Scripture because I realized the ultimate goal for us, from what I understood, the goal for us to be tonight was to talk to us as men about what should really matter to us.
Yes, sir.
So I say amen to
that. Amen.
And I think in order for us to get a visual of what God really had in sight or in mind to matter to us, we should have to venture just a little bit further down in the Scriptures to Genesis 12. And I think I learned from my leader, and I'm his protege, Dr. Coleman, that this was probably the first calling out of a church, of an organized group of people instructed to follow God. And that leader at that time, the man that was called and formed this organization was Abraham.
All right.
Abram at that time.
Yes, sir.
If you would, let's venture into the Scriptures. Genesis 12, starting at verse 1. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and I will curse him that curses thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. That's enough to talk about tonight. That's enough to instruct anyone desiring to be instructed on tonight. I was privileged, able, and blessed to talk with some children from Bastrop High School, the Bastrop High football team, last week about a great opportunity they had. If anyone knows anything about Bastrop sports, you know that Bastrop has been under the guidance of a new coach. And that coach started his year out with a team that he was presented, was the challenge of another team that was presented to him, and ended the year with that same team. So and my message to those young men on that night was a do-over. You know, anytime we are presented with the opportunity to do something over, we're supposed to do better, right? We're supposed to be able to attack this challenge with more velocity than we did on the last time, because we've been there before, right? So tonight I was able to pin and point things and kind of get that wrapped around and wanted you guys to wrap it around your head tonight. That tonight is a do-over.
Oh, yeah.
We, we presented with another do-over. Brother Daniels has told us some things that should actually guide us and enable us to actually live a better life. Amen?
Amen.
Live a life that seemed to be or would be more instructed by God, right? And his format came from back to the basics,
right.
Back to your foundation, back to the things that we were instructed early on. And I think we find ourselves in that condition tonight. And the thing that would help us the most if we would absorb is, am I going to apply what I've heard here tonight?
Amen.
Is it important enough to apply to my life? And another challenge, the third challenge is, how do I apply to my life? I thought you never had. You see, the first thing that Abram was instructed to do was to, or commanded at that point, was to come out from your land, your country. And do we understand tonight that our development depends on a lot from the land that we come from? The place that we live, the neighborhoods that we hung out of or kicked it in, that developed a lot in us.
That's right.
So God instructed Abram to come out from those things,
right.
and leave the place that you know as home, your comfort zone.
That's right.
Come out of your comfort zone.
Right.
Your stance, the stance that you take upon in your life, it depended upon where you came from.
Right.
A lot of the things that you believe come from the land that you lived upon, the place and the community that you chose or was chosen to be your home tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Your physical and your mental views about you, everybody and everything else, you've got to come out from it.
Mm-hmm.
You see, from being the norm, God instructed Abraham not to be norm anymore, not to be amongst the norm.
Yeah.
From being the old man that you used to be.
All right.
The old father that you used to be.
Yeah.
The old husband that you used to be.
Mm-hmm.
And the old friend that you used to be.
Well.
He was instructed to come out from there.
Well.
The old way has got to go.
Uh-huh.
Your old ways shouldn't matter anymore. Understanding that he wants you to be the righteousness of God.
Yes.
You see, I heard this the other day when I was listening to ministry. I think it was Brother Daryl. Mm-hmm. And I know I've heard it and read it before, but you got to understand, as a man, how can God get activities performed on earth unless he does it through man?
Amen.
I think Brother Dollar told us that you are the righteousness of God.
Uh-huh.
And I kind of took that with me, and it kind of resonated on my mind that in everything that I do, I should be seeking to be the righteousness of God.
Amen.
So tonight when I leave this place, and I'm a married man, and when I'm headed somewhere I shouldn't be going,
uh-huh,
I got to think to myself, I'm the righteousness of God.
And
if you like me, you can believe when you leave this place, if you headed to the liquor store, or you headed to your girlfriend's house, or you may be headed to your boyfriend's house, you may be gender confused. If you repeat to yourself that I am the righteousness of God, if you do that enough, when you get there one day, you might want to turn around. You might be influenced to go away. But you got to have some basis within yourself and understand that, hey, first of all, I am the righteousness of God. And if God wants some righteousness to be done, it has to come through who? It comes through me. So and when I choose to do something other than being righteous, and I'm standing repeating to myself that I am the righteousness of God, something has divided there. And we have to understand that something is going to connect one day, and that wheel is going to turn in a positive way. If I keep repeating to myself, I am something, eventually I'll become it. Amen?
Amen.
So understand, we got to come out from our old ways of living. Come out from our old way of thinking. And most of all, come out from our old way of doing things. The next command we need to follow is the way Abram was instructed to come out from anyone or anything, mostly kindred, that may hinder you on your going. That may be a friend. That may be your family. Brothers, I came to instruct you tonight. It may even be your first lady. We got to come out from anyone if we want the blessings from God. We got to come out from anything, any person that hinders us from that. Right. And we got, first of all, we need to realize that everybody is not going to be in your corner. Right. I think I started my ministry journey about 5 years ago, and I got some people that I hadn't talked to now in about 5 years. Because everybody is not going to be your support system. Right. So if we wait, like Brother said, if we wait upon the ones, and if we move as we're instructed towards God, if we wait upon the ones that's put for us, the ones that's going to be for us, the one that God has in our path, then we'll have the right one. So whether your kindred, your wife, your friends, your co-workers, come out from those that don't have the ultimate goal in their process of thinking. You see, we got to understand that everybody's not going to be supportive of the ministry. Everybody's definitely not going to be supportive of your ministry. So we have to come out from those that aren't supportive of the voyage. Amen?
Amen.
And last, and but certainly not least, he was instructed to come out from under the rule of anything other than him. You see, God needs you to be like a blank piece of paper. He needs you to be blank, and then he can use you. You see, he doesn't need you with your view or anything else that you may come with. He doesn't need your old support system. And neither does he need you being influenced by anything but his word.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Somebody tell the Lord, thank you. Like,
thank you.
Amen. So I leave with you this day and this night the thing that should matter to a real man is stepping out of his comfort zone. Coming away from his common people and not worrying about the complaining and commands of anybody other than God.
Yes, sir.
Because y'all, I know a man. I know a man that nothing else mattered to him but serving God.
Yeah.
Somebody ought to say thank you for allowing me to serve you this evening. I know a man that went down on a hill called Calvary. Brother Daniel told us, it's one that'll help.
Yeah.
And I came to reiterate that it's a man went down on a hill called Calvary.
Yes,
and he didn't die for his sins, y'all. He died for my sins.
Yes,
he died for your sins.
Yes,
he died for our sins. And if we just wait and follow the instructions,
yes.
If we follow the instructions,
yes.
The scripture says, then we will be blessed.
Yes.
It says he will bless those that bless you.
Yes.
It says that he will curse those that curse you.
Well,
what better man would that be to follow?
Right.
We know it. We know it, y'all.
Yes.
We know what he did for us.
Yes.
We know what he did on a hill called Calvary.
Yes.
Y'all, they buried him.
Yes,
yes, they did. They buried him, y'all. Yeah. They buried him. And y'all know he stayed right there, don't you?
Yeah.
How many of us would have stayed right there?
Oh.
He stayed right there all night, Friday night, y'all.
Yeah.
When some of us would have gotten up, even though we hadn't done anything, some of us would have gotten up, but y'all, he stayed right there.
Yes,
he stayed for you. For me, for us, all day Saturday,
well,
all day Saturday, he was right there, and y'all know Saturday night, he was still there too, but y'all know what happened
early.
Y'all, early Sunday morning, our risen Savior got up, and he had all power, he had all power, reserved for you, me, and I.
Yes.
Y'all,
yes,
let's use what we got. Let's use what we've been given to serve God.
Yes.
And let's understand it starts from the foundation. We have to go back. And nobody ever said it would be easy. It's strange to me that Brother Daniel would talk about one cell and being the way it is. And then we have common knowledge of what Bastrop is here to us. Y'all, it kind of, you know, I kind of fit everything spiritually or scripturally. It kind of seems to me like Sodom. And Gomorrah.
Yes.
But Abraham pleaded.
Yes.
If it's, he came all the way down to 10.
Uh-huh.
Y'all, it's 10 good people in Bethlehem.
Uh-huh.
It's 10 good people in Monticello. I'm quite sure it's 10 good people in Monticello.
Uh-huh.
So y'all, the foundation is great.
Yeah.
We just got to stand up. Amen.
Uh-huh.
Somebody tell the Lord, thank you.
Thank you.
That's my time.
Thank you.